I have to admit, I've been curious about Godfall for a while, and once I saw it drop in price, I had to try it out, and I'm glad I did. It didn't get the best reception when it was released, but I think there are some people who would really enjoy the game if they gave it a chance. However, I can still understand why it was hit with mixed reviews when it was released, and we'll go over why that is. Considering the game is coming to PS4 along with a big update in August, I figured now would be the best time to take a look at the game and let everyone know if it's worth buying or not. I did end up platinuming the game as well, and while I will be going over trophy requirements, this video will end up being more review heavy than my other platinum trophy videos. So first off, presentation wise, this game is absolutely gorgeous. While I'm still not clear on why they made it a next gen and PC exclusive, especially considering it's now coming to last gen consoles, it does absolutely show off the horsepower of the PlayStation 5. Gorgeous metallic structures along with a really strong art direction make an excellent showing for next gen consoles. There's two modes for the PlayStation 5, one that favors a higher graphical fidelity at 30fps, and one with a lower resolution but targeting 60fps. And while the higher graphics mode looked beyond stunning, I stuck with the 60fps mode. There's a night and day difference gameplay-wise for an action game when you compare 30 to 60fps, so the 30fps option was never really an option. It does do a good job at hitting 60fps in the first world, although later on frame rate drops do become pretty common. There's really no reason why the PlayStation 5 shouldn't be able to do 60fps in a modern game, and the game probably did need some more optimization. Part of the problem, I think, is that the developers really wanted to show off the power of the PlayStation 5, as they added in an insane amount of particle effects. Don't get me wrong, they look great, but it's so over the top that I couldn't see or tell what was going on fairly often in bigger battles. And those moments do seem to be the biggest culprit when it comes to frame rate drops, so I do think the developers need to tone them down for the frame rate mode. As far as the story goes, it's almost non-existent, or at least it seems that way at first. The character you play is Orin, and his brother Makros had a falling out over being the only heir to the throne. Makros became delusional and wanted to become a god, so you confronted him, lost the battle, and then was left for dead. You enlist the aid of the Seventh Sanctum to help you stop your brother from ascending to godhood. The game basically consists of you traveling between three zones and taking out your brother's closest advisors. No real characterization is given to them through the main story outside of, these guys are bad, so go kill them because they're bad. The story is essentially a very thin veil to glue together the loot grind, and I do wish they had put more effort into it because, as we will discuss shortly, the combat actually has some interesting mechanics to it. Or at least I would say all that if it wasn't for the journal entries scattered across levels and hidden areas. Once I read them, I realized they actually had an interesting story to tell. They just made it very obtuse to actually experience that story. Hiding away journal entries that really tell the majority of the story is not a good way to tell a narrative. Reading them actually made me have some interest in the world, and they did have some characterization to your brother Makros and even Orin himself. From researching the studio behind the game Counterplay Games, they do seem like a really talented and passionate studio. The issue I think they ran into was their team works remotely, is mid-sized, and they have limited funding. The issue with constructing a narrative with tons of cutscenes and voice acting is that it's very expensive. While I do wish they had done all that, I do understand they wanted to make the best game they could on the budget they had, so they chose to focus on the combat over all else. And I am happy to say they did a great job for the most part. You're the last of the Valyrian Knights, which means you are able to equip Valor Plates. These armor sets grant the user incredible power, and each one has its own unique ability. I have to say, I love the design of them, and it was an interesting concept to have the player collect them throughout the game. There's three mission zones, but you start off in the Earth Zone, which ended up being the best designed one. It's a mixture of forested areas with rivers running through it, along with a massive castle to explore. This zone had a strong sense of exploration, as there were secret chests and resources to find everywhere. It was also a bit more open than the other two zones. While it wasn't exactly an open world, there are plenty of wide open areas to explore with multiple branching paths. The last two areas did have a few branching paths also, but they were far more linear and didn't feel as well crafted. After you finish a mission, you have the option to stay in the zone and explore to get additional experience and resources. I did this in every mission in the first area, but after that, the other zones just weren't interesting enough to continue exploring. Missions generally have you hunt a specific enemy or activate a beacon. The game is dominated by the loot grind, so essentially every gameplay mechanic is built around it. And the main campaign is pretty short. If you don't spend much time exploring after missions, you can finish it in under 15 hours easily. But like most live service games, the real game starts once you beat the last boss and get into the endgame. Now, what initially interested me in the game was the combat, and while there were some issues with it, overall it did not disappoint. There's a blend of systems that give it a unique feel while it's still being familiar. As you level up, you obtain skill points suspended in a giant skill tree that can unlock a ton of combat moves, along with standard moves being unlocked as you progress throughout the game. Like most melee combat games, you have your standard light and heavy attacks that you can mix together for a combo, or charge up the heavy attack to do a blow with extra damage. You also have your now bog standard dodge and parry defensive abilities, however, there's a much stronger emphasis on parrying over dodging. Along with those standard moves, there's a lot of different systems in play to keep track of. In so many games, you can just spam the light attacks, making heavy attacks almost useless, but the Godfall developers had a great idea to work around this. While you still will mostly want to spam light attacks, you do actually need to use the heavy ones as well. Light attacks will do two forms of damage to the enemy, one being just straight up damage, and the other will show extra damage highlighted in white that will be dealt once you follow up with a heavy attack. On top of this, there's a stun system called breaching, which once breached, an enemy will take extra damage, and certain enemies will be opened up to a takedown attack. There's also the polarity system that causes your secondary weapon to build up a charge when you attack. Once the charge is full, you can switch to your second weapon, which shoots out an AoE blast and does extra damage for a short duration. You can also throw your shield, which can knock down smaller enemies, opening them up to a takedown attack as well. The shield is also used for some very light puzzle elements, like breaking up hidden seals to unlock treasure chests. Each weapon also has its own unique feel and helps give even more variation to the combat. There's a ton of other moves as well you can unlock from the skill tree that really give the combat a unique feel, but I'd be here all day if I went over all of them. Suffice to say, overall, I thought the combat system was well thought out, and when it clicked on all cylinders, it was extremely fun. The issue I ran into was while the combat was well designed, it didn't always work properly, and I'll be going over that later in the review. As you defeat enemies, you'll level up and earn skill points to spend in a rather large skill tree. Like I said earlier, there's tons of moves to unlock, but also your standard things like increasing certain types of damage. The only issue I had with it is that it seems really like only one or two builds are vastly better than everything else, which didn't leave much room for experimentation, especially if you're mostly playing solo like I did. Once you hit max level, you start to earn ascension levels, which give you even more skill points to spend in a new skill tree that can improve your stats even further. The game was marketed as a looter slasher, and I think that was a mistake on the marketing's part. They really should have highlighted the unique combat systems that do seem to really hook players who invest time into the game. But that being said, yes, there's a ton of loot. The gear system isn't the most in-depth one I've ever seen, but it gets the job done. You can equip two weapons, a banner, lifestone, two rings, an amulet, and a trinket. Each gear piece has the standard rare, epic, and legendary variants, but what I do like is that anything outside of a common piece of gear can be upgraded to the legendary quality. So if you find a ring with a particular stat you like, you're free to level it up to legendary rarity along with improving it up to 5 times. This can be extremely resource intensive, and I did find it to be just a little too costly to upgrade gear. It made experimenting with different builds, of which there are tons of possibilities, almost impossible, so I had to just stick with one build while going for the platinum. Although people who do continue to grind will eventually have enough to build up multiple different sets. I touched on Valor Plates before, and while they seem at first very different from each other, in reality they're really just more cosmetic. Most suits increase your chance to put a damage over time attack on your foes, like setting them on fire, chilling them, or cursing them. At first, I assumed each different effect did something different, like chill slowed enemies. But they all simply do a standard damage over time attack, nothing else, so there's really not much difference between them. Each Valor Plate does give a different Archon ability, which does actually have a few different variations. They are special attacks you can form once your Archon meter builds up, and they can deal absolutely devastating damage. Overall, I was somewhat shocked at how well designed the combat was given the mixed review scores the game received at launch. That being said, while the combat was well made, there are issues with the game. Like I mentioned earlier, the story had some serious issues, and I do wish they actually used the really great story they crafted more front and center instead of hiding it away in hidden lore collectibles. Also, the game can be extremely repetitive. Once you beat the short campaign, you'll be grinding the same few areas over and over. And the final dungeon, if you want to call it that, is simply just an elevator that goes up floors that all basically look identical that you fight the same enemies over and over in. There are a decent amount of standard enemies, but not nearly enough different bosses to give the game variety. Also, the game is extremely buggy, especially in the late game. This review actually got delayed because I couldn't get the last trophy due to the final dungeon, Ascended Tower of Trials, continually glitching out on me. Not to mention, certain aspects of the combat would randomly stop working, which made the game impossible to play at times. It's odd because running through the campaign, I ran into very few issues. Yeah, the dodge system wouldn't work right always, and there were some hit detection issues, but nothing major. It wasn't until the endgame where I really ran into severe problems. Also, the multiplayer leaves a considerable amount to be desired.
At time of writing, there's no matchmaking, but they will be adding it in the next big update in August.
This meant I had to find people on Reddit and Discord, which I shouldn't have had to do. It should be just drop in and play. That being said, the Godfall community is one of the nicest and best online communities I've seen while trophy hunting. They are extremely passionate about the game and are very willing to help out newer players. Shout out to everyone I grouped with, I wish all multiplayer communities were like you guys. While I was planning on soloing the Platinum, I ran into so many issues it became basically impossible for me to solo it, but I'm glad I did engage with the multiplayer because when it works, it's extremely fun. Sometimes it would lag, although there were times it was perfectly fine. It's probably dependent on how far away the people you're playing with are. And while this will be a PlayStation 5 specific problem, I noticed a lot of issues with the DualSense. At times the combat would become unresponsive and it took me a while to realize it was the adaptive triggers causing the issue. As far as the trophy requirements go, it was actually a great list outside of the last trophy, which requires you to make it to floor 20 of the Ascended Tower of Trials. You basically need to get a certain amount of kills with each weapon type and do each type of damage over time attack a certain amount of times. Along with those, it's basically just story trophies then the final tower. The problem is the endgame can get pretty challenging and you absolutely need to grind up your ascension levels and upgrade your gear fully. It is easier to do things in a group, but you only get 3 deaths to split between your group and the final tower, so if you're undergeared, even if you have someone carrying you, it's not a guarantee you'll make it through the last trial. All in all, the Platinum took me about 31 hours, which is less than I thought it would end up taking. And no trophies were missable, and you can Platinum it solo. You are not required to play the multiplayer, which is always a plus. Although I would again recommend playing the multiplayer because I had a ton of fun with it. Overall, I found myself enjoying the game quite a bit, despite its flaws. Also, considering the trophy list was really well done, I'm going to award Godfall a gold trophy. I do think that if more people gave the game a shot, they might find they like it too. And if you're into trophy hunting and looking for something different to Platinum, I do think Godfall is a great choice. However, I would still pick it up on sale, and it's not going to be for everyone. Really make sure you understand what you're getting into before you buy it. They showed off a new update at E3 which will be coming out in August alongside the PS4 release. This update seems like it will fix some of the issues I had with the game, and from what they've shown us so far, it looks like the game will be getting even better. I do think this game would be perfect for Game Pass, and I hope once the PlayStation exclusivity runs out, they put it on there along with crossplay and matchmaking. This would give the game a consistently healthy stream of new players, and if they keep improving the game with future updates and expansions, this game could end up being one of the best success stories we've seen with live services that have poorly received launches only to turn things around in a few years. Like I said, I think the devs are very passionate about their game, and I do hope they turn things around. And I will definitely be checking out the expansion when it comes out in August myself, so expect a video on that when it launches. I am currently also working on the Mass Effect 3 Platinum, so expect that video in the near future, along with a few other reviews like Mario Golf Super Rush. If you did enjoy the video, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe. Thanks so much for watching, I'll see you all in the next video.